Casual. I'm Ralph Gleason. We've been listening to the music of Sonny Rollins and Company with Jim Hall on guitar, Bob Cranshaw on bass, Ben Riley on drums. Sonny Rollins, the tenor saxophonist, is one of the true virtuoso jazz soloists in modern jazz, and we're going to have a chance now to talk to him. Sonny, when you pick tunes that you're going to use in your group and on which you're going to improvise, what kind of things do you look for?
Well, the rhythm, I would say, is really the most important aspect of jazz. And usually the melodic content of a tune is of secondary importance in that we can take any tune and really put a jazz rhythm to it, and it would sound very acceptable and very good.
Do you ever become intrigued by a tune because of the melody?
Oh, very definitely, yeah. Of course, when you have melody and rhythm together, why, then on that third point, you really get the beautiful manifestation of whatever it might be.
Mm-hmm. Do you sometimes hear someone play a tune and then think about it yourself before you you decide to use it, think about things you might do with it?
Uh-huh. Now, exactly what do you mean by that?
Well, do you hear a song played by another group and decide that you like it and you might like to try your hand with it? If you do this, do you then consider the song yourself before you play it and think about the changes in it?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, of course, every time I hear a song, I hear it harmonically, melodically, and rhythmically at the same time. Yeah. So I usually hear all of these things when I listen to a song, and Of course, then I just about gauged the potentialities and the possibilities for applying it to our particular group.
Do you do the same tunes, when you do the same tunes, different performances, do they follow the same structure?
Usually, although there's so much difference in the solos themselves that it's hard to say that it follows the same structure. As you know, jazz is such an extemporaneous thing that we do a great deal of improvising right on the spot. But we usually maintain a framework within which all this is done, so it's pretty well compact, and the form is there. But within that form, of course, it's very free, you know.
So that if you did something as you were soloing, this might change the whole way the group would perform the rest of the tune?
Yes, it would. Yes, very definitely.
Will that work back then as a feedback to you?
Very definitely. And we get ideas as we go along. And even though we might play the same song, we might just put a little inflection here and inflection there, which we might pick up from one of the other guys in the group. And this would change the whole color, so to speak, of the song. And of course, this makes it very nice to play because it's a different experience each time, you know.
But you still have little places where you do the same kind of things at various points in a performance, do you?
Yes, definitely, definitely. We have places where we mark, I guess they could be called sort of like landmarks along the way. And of course, this discipline enables us to be free and to do things freely, you know.
Do you ever vary the tempos in which you play tunes from performance to performance?
Occasionally, although we usually have a set idea of what would be the best tempo for any particular song, and there might be very slight, very not too much. It might go a little bit faster, a little slower, but by and large, I think we do everything about the same thing that we agree upon.
How about keys? Do you ever change the key?
Yeah, we do that. And we're just beginning to do a lot more of that, to play in keys which we might not have played in too much before. So now we play the same song, and we're beginning to play it in different keys. And of course, each key gives it a different sound. Once again, it makes it a little different. The same notes in a different key would produce a different color, you know.
This makes you think about it in a new way, then.
Definitely,
It produces new versions, then.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Very interesting.
Sonny, many young musicians today, it seems to me, have lost sight of the fact that jazz has had a tradition going back several generations. When you came along as a tenor saxophone player, who were the saxophone players in which you were interested?
Well, I was quite interested in Coleman Hawkins, and he was my main guy that I liked. Of course, I still do admire him. And I liked Lester Young, and I liked quite a few guys. In fact, I liked most guys that were playing. Because I just like Hawk more than the others, because he happens to be my particular idol, so to speak.
These older musicians have had an influence on you? And
definitely. A great many of them helped the young guys, like I was at that time. I'm an old man now, but at that time I was helped a great deal by guys like Ben, you know, and Hawk and so forth, and they gave me a lot of good hints, which I use now. And the same way, I would like to have a chance to help some of the young kids coming along.
Yes.
You know?
Well, of course, one of the greatest ways you can help them is by continuing to play the way you're playing, be an inspiration to them.
Great. I'm glad you said that.
What are you going to play for us now, son?
Well, I think we're going to do a short version of God Bless the Child.
Billie Holiday.
Billie Holiday,
beautiful.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Thank you very much.
Thank you
for hearing that.
Great.
We've been talking to Sonny Rollins, the tenor saxophone player, and we've learned some of the ways in which jazz musicians think about improvisation and how they use, in Sonny's words, rhythm and melody and harmony in their approach to a performance. And Sonny has also told us something about the traditions of jazz, and now we're going to hear him and his group play God Bless the Child. Sonny Rollins has been giving us an example of spontaneous improvisation in jazz on Jazz Casual. And now back to Sonny Rollins for some more.
¶¶